In this module, we're talking about colligative properties, specifically boiling point elevation, freezing point depression, and osmotic pressure. First of all, what a colligative property is. It's a property of a solution that depends only upon how many solute particles there are and not their identity. So boiling point elevation, first of all, this is the important equation that you're going to memorize. It says that the change in the boiling point of a solvent is equal to something called the Van 't Hoff factor times the molality of that solution times the what's called the boiling point elevation constant. So first of all, parts of this equation. The change in the boiling point is the boiling point of the solution minus the boiling point of the pure solvent before you add something in. Now it ends up that for any liquid, if you add a non-volatile solute, you will increase the boiling point. That's what this is describing of that of this resulting solution compared to the pure solvent. Because this number is always bigger than this, this will always be a positive number. This I, the Van 't Hoff factor, this is the definition. It's the moles of particles in the solution divided by the moles of the solute. Now, if it's a molecular compound, then I, the Van 't Hoff factor, is just one, because for every particle of that molecule you put in there, you just get, you know, it's the same particle and solute. However, if it's an ionic compound, then it can dissociate in that solution, and when it does, you create more particles. For example, if you put sodium chloride into water, it dissociates into sodium ions and chloride ions, so it would be about 2/1. So one for every 1 mole of sodium chloride, we'd get about 2 moles of particles, roughly. Come back to that in a second. Molality is the same as we saw before. Remember the definition of molality? It's moles of solute divided by kilograms of solvent. And this boiling point elevation constant is constant. You look it up, you don't have to memorize any of them. Just the only thing, the important thing to remember is that you look it up based upon what the solvent is, that's all. So this Van 't Hoff factor. So like we were saying, if it's sodium chloride, we'd expect every 1 formula unit of sodium chloride to break up into 2 particles, the sodium ion and the chloride ion. We'd expect it to be the Van 't Hoff factor to be 2.0. In fact, it's about 1.9. The reason for this is something called ion pairing. So when we put that sodium chloride in the water, okay, most of the sodium ions and the chloride ions separate from each other, and they're surrounded by a sphere of solvation, by water molecules. However, some of them still stay associated with each other. And that means instead of getting 2 particles, this whole thing here only counts as 1 particle. Magnesium chloride, we'd expect to get 3 particles, 2 chlorides and 1 magnesium. So we'd expect the Van 't Hoff factor to be 3. In fact, it's 2.7. And here, just for comparison, notice that glucose, which is a molecular compound, does not dissociate. So we'd expect its Van 't Hoff factor to be 1, and it actually is. So freezing point depression works like boiling point elevation, except that the freezing point of a solution is always lower than the freezing point of the pure solvent when you add a non-volatile solute to it. So here, the delta TF, the change in the freezing point, it's equal to the freezing point of the solution minus the freezing point of the solvent, pure solvent. Now, because this will be lower than this, this will be a negative number, delta TF. When you're putting it into this equation here to use it, just make it positive. It'll work out better that way. Same Van 't Hoff factor, same molality. The freezing point depression constant, again, it depends only upon what the solvent is. You look it up, you don't have to memorize any of them. So why does this happen? Well, this is a phase diagram for water. Please pardon my attempt to draw curves here. But the idea is this. We know from the last module that by adding a solute to a solvent, we lower the vapor pressure of the resulting solution. And so in this phase diagram, remember it's solid over here, it's liquid here, and it's gas over here. So this is pressure versus temperature. As we go along this curve, the pressure along this curve here will be the vapor pressure of that liquid, in this case water. So by adding the solute, we lower the vapor pressure. That's why the green curve, which is the vapor pressure of the solution, is lower than the white curve, which is the vapor pressure of pure water. So green is the vapor pressure of the solution, white is the vapor pressure of water. And so if we look at, okay, so this is one atmosphere, the external pressure, right? Let's say the atmospheric pressure is one atmosphere. The solution or the solvent will boil when its vapor pressure is equal to the external pressure. So when the vapor pressure reaches one atmosphere, that temperature is the boiling point. Because this curve is higher than this curve, we reach that point at a lower temperature for the pure solvent than we do for the solution. This difference here is the change in the boiling point elevation, going from here, pure solvent, to here, the solution. Same thing works with the freezing point, only the opposite way. This is the temperature at which we go from liquid to solid or solid to liquid, the freezing point. So for pure solvent, in this case water, it would be this temperature right here. The lowering of the vapor pressure of the solution means that it freezes at a lower temperature here. And this difference here will be the change in the freezing point. Now, remember, when we talked about vapor pressure lowering by the addition of a solute, we talked about how entropy is involved. It still applies here. It's the same reasoning. All right, so the other colligative property is osmotic pressure. This is supposed to be a pi, Greek letter pi, capital. And osmotic pressure is equal to the Van't'Hoff factor, same as before. Now this M is the molarity, not the molality. Watch out, it's a capital M, times the gas law constant, which we know from before, from the gas chapter. And T is the temperature in Kelvin. R, remember, is 0.08206 liters atmospheres per Kelvin mole. And that's only 4 sig figs. So what is osmotic pressure? Well, it ends up, if you put a solution and separate it from some of its solvent by what's called a semi-permeable membrane, the column of liquid on the side of the solution will rise, but you can stop it from rising by exerting a pressure on it. And that pressure for that solution is the osmotic pressure of that solution. So if we look at it, what this semi-permeable membrane does is it allows solvent particles to pass through, but not solute particles. So what will happen here is, just left to its own, the pure solvent side is going to try to dilute the solution side, and it's trying to get the concentration the same on both sides, zero. Can never get there. But what happens is, as the solvent particles pass through the semi-permeable membrane, this column of liquid starts increasing in height. And just like with that mercury barometer we talked about in the gas chapter, as it goes up higher and higher in this column, gravity is exerting a force down and thus creating a pressure at this barrier. And when it reaches a height such that the pressure exerted down balances the pressure of the solvent coming through, it stops rising. That difference is a measure of the osmotic pressure. So let's do an example. This one happens to deal with freezing point depression, but boiling point elevation and osmotic pressure calculations are pretty similar. Just remember those equations. So we have 1 gram of quinine, it's a molecule, a molecular compound. It's dissolved in 10 grams of cyclohexane. So quinine is a molecular compound, as is cyclohexane, it ends up. The freezing point of the resulting solution is 0.24 degrees Celsius, almost zero, not quite. What's the molar mass of quinine? If we have pure cyclohexane, it ends up that it freezes at 6.47 degrees Celsius. And the freezing point depression constant for the solvent, which is cyclohexane, is this, 20.2 kelvins per molal. So here our approach is going to be, we're going to use the freezing point depression equation. And we're going to solve it for the molality. The freezing point, it's the freezing point of the solution minus the freezing point of the pure solvent, which is 0.24 minus 6.47 degrees. It's negative 6.23 degrees Celsius. And because the difference in the temperature in Celsius is the same as the difference in Kelvin, this is also the difference in the freezing point. The change in the freezing point is also negative 6.23 Kelvin. Think about that if you're not sure why that is, but that's true. And so now we have the freezing point depression equation. We're going to solve for the molality. Here, because quinine is a molecular compound, I is 1. So we don't have to worry about it. If we solve for the molality, just divide the change in the freezing point, we're going to make it positive, by the, well, I, the Van 't Hoff factor times the freezing point depression constant, I is 1. We saw that K sub F is 20.2. I gave that to you in the problem. Do the division, we get 0.308, 3 sig figs, first insignificant figures of 4 molality. So that's the molality of the solution. But we want the molar mass of the quinine. So what we're going to do is, because the definition of molality is moles of solute over kilograms of solvent, and we know how many kilograms of solvent, which is cyclohexane, we had 10.0 grams, which is 0.01000 kilograms, two zeros after that. If we multiply the molality that we just figured out times the kilograms of solvent, we get moles of solute. So this is moles of quinine, the solute. And all we have to do now to get the molar mass is take the mass of the quinine in grams divided by the moles, grams per mole. So the molality was 1 gram divided by that many moles. And we do the division, we get to 3 sig figs anymore, 3.24 grams per mole. And there you go.